This is as close as I hope I'll ever get to it, because we're going to talk about the creatures that are my most sworn enemies. And the thing is, I rationally know that, like, they can't and won't do anything to me. And yet, just the sight of them makes my blood run cold. I'm talking about rodents. And today, in How to Be an Adult, we are going to learn how to deal with them if they make their way into your life. So, good morning to Richard Faulkner, who is Advanced Technical Field Consultant with Rentokil, with 23 years experience in this business. Richard, how are you?
Good morning. How are you?
I may freak out during this conversation. I just think it's important that you know that.
I hope not.
So, Richard, tell me, how did you come to do the job that you do?
Oh, it's one of those, nobody plans to be a pest controller.
Yeah.
I've always sort of loved wildlife and animals and insects and stuff as a kid. I then went in, sort of did my schooling, went to university, did an environmental biology degree. I sort of wanted to end up like David Attenborough, to be honest.
Right.
It didn't quite happen. So when I finished uni, I got the chance to come over to Ireland to do work at a marine station, Shetland Island Marine Station. And then when I left that, I sort of fell into pest control, and I've been doing it for almost 23 years since.
And is that not kind of at odds with your love of animals? Like, do you feel bad?
No, because a lot of what we're doing is environmental control.
Right.
We're looking at the places or the sites we're looking at from an environmental perspective. So the actual destruction of animals is sort of the last part.
Right.
So there's other things that we can do. Looking at landscaping, looking at how our buildings are proof to stop them getting in, taking away what they need in the environment to make the environment that we're treating more sort of hostile to them, so they don't actually want to be there.
Right. Okay. That makes sense. So one thing I want to get out of the way straight away is I think a lot of people have an idea, and I certainly have had an idea, that wintertime is the time that creatures like to come into your house because it's warm and it's dry, and that in spring and summer you're kind of grand. But is that the case?
No, not really anymore, because we're getting a lot milder winters for a start. So populations are bigger. There's a lot of carrying capacity because naturally abundant foods, grains, fruits are doing really, really well. So it's not really that case anymore.
Okay.
And then what we found as well, because of lockdown, there's less abundant sort of food waste and stuff about. Restaurants being closed for long periods of time, pubs being closed for long periods of time. So especially in our urban areas, bin waste, park waste and stuff like that's been reduced. So like any animal, rodents need food, water, shelter. So they're going to come looking for those. And the main species that we deal with, what we call our target species, which are our common rat and our house mouse, are what we call commensal rodents. So they've adapted to live around man. So, yeah, we sort of
and
a constant battle from that point of view.
How likely are you to know if you have rodents who've come into your home?
See, that's the thing. Before we were all locked down in our homes a lot more than we ever used to, we were going off for long periods of the day. So, again, these animals, rodents are generally nocturnal. They like a stable, quiet environment. So when we're out of buildings, it's better for time for them to move about. So that's why people are sort of more aware of them now, seeing them more in their gardens, and seeing more evidence of them in their houses. So it's really about the evidence. So the most obvious sign that you've got them is when they tap dance out in front of you, either in your garden or in your kitchen or wherever they are, or when you're watching TV at night when a mouse runs across your sitting room floor, which is fantastic. Droppings as well, like a house mouse produces 80 droppings a day. A common rat's going to produce 40 droppings a day.
And what do they look like? And I know, I'm sorry, by the way, if you're listening and this is hard for you, you feel free to turn off for 10 or 15 minutes.
If you're about to have breakfast.
But yeah, but this is important that we know. Like, this is what this lot is all about. It's about facing off to things that we should know as adults. So what do they look like so that you can identify them?
So, A mouse droppings, to me, the best way to describe it sort of visually would be, it's almost like a grain of rice size. It's spindle shaped, so it's papered at each end. and it is like just like a little burnt grain of rice.
Okay.
It's all germinated dark. Rat dropping is roughly 10 to 12 mils, and it's sausage shaped and tapered at one end.
Okay. Okay. So you get the idea. First of all, no, let's do something calming. They're not going to do anything to you, right? These, you know, what you're talking about here, these rats and mice, like, they're not going to hurt you, are they?
It's like any animal. No animal's going to, especially a small animal, their first instinct is going to be to run away from you.
Yeah, they're scared of you.
Yeah. So from that point of view, the only point is if somebody tries to grab it, it's like anything. If you grab a dog that doesn't like to be touched, it's going to try and defend itself.
Right.
But it's very, very rare, one, that you're going to be in that close proximity to a rodent or get it cornered in that situation.
Yeah.
The likelihood of physical damage from that point of view or for harm is very, very rare. It's really just the pathogens that are associated with them.
Yeah.
So the bacteria and viruses that they can transmit.
Okay, right. So then you're in a situation where you've either seen, you've been watching TV and a mouse has tapped onto in front of you across, or, you know, you've heard sounds or you believe that you have rodents in your house. Yeah. What do you do? Like, how do you figure out, for one, where they are? Like, can you stop them from coming in? Like, do you have to do building work? What do you do?
Each situation can be different, and that's the thing. If we're trying to avoid getting rodents in our house, and I think that being proactive is the best thing, so we don't get to that point.
Yes, please.
So, yeah, if you start outside in your sort of gardens and the surrounds of your house, so any overgrown vegetation, cut it back, because that just provides harborage. I've got some lovely brambles at the back of my garden there, which really should be cut back, because in a few months, it could be fruiting and we could have blackberries, which is a food source.
Okay.
So stuff like that needs to be cut back. If you've got animals that you feed outside, once the animals are fed, clean up the bowl, clean up the area.
Okay.
Don't leave food out in bowls.
What about bird seed? I've heard bad things about bird seed.
Well, again, it's a lovely food source. So anything like that. So if you've got bird feeders, get the ones that are sort of suspended and harder to get to. For like up in trees and stuff like that. If you're putting food out for the birds, again, put little amounts out so that the birds feed on it quite happily and there's not excess food, because excess food is just going to attract pests. Mm. Same with your bins. Try and keep all your waste in bins, keep the lids on the bins, and just keep your bins away from your house.
So you're really just trying to make your house as unattractive as possible. Because at the end of the day, and this is, I'm trying to calm myself down, these are tiny creatures who are hungry and want to be warm. And that's understandable. And that is not a bad desire to have. Yeah, I just don't want them to do it in my home. So.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's looking at them like little unwanted lodgers.
Yeah.
And so exactly that's what they want. They want exactly the same things that we want to. They want food, water, warmth and shelter.
Yeah.
And then a mate so they can have little ones.
Okay, so you're doing all that to try and keep your house as unattractive as possible.
Yeah.
But, you know, what if you're in the situation where they're in and it's too late?
So if we've done that sort of bit, which is a restriction, we then need to look at sealing the house where we can. So especially if you seal it for mice, then it's going to keep rats out as well.
Yeah.
So any gap of 5 mils or more circumference, any gap really over 5 mils.
How big is 5 mils? Like how?
So if you can get a pen through it, you will get a mouse through it.
Wow. Okay.
So if we can seal all those gaps,
I'm moving.
That's fantastic.
I need a new house. Okay.
On that one, especially when you look at where your surfaces come in, so water pipes for your sinks. If you run cable or anything like that, if you've had any work done with, you've had remodeling done, and things have changed about. So the old pathways into surfaces, if they've taken pipes out, just make sure everything's properly sealed on the outside.
Mm-hmm. And is that a big job? So, like, if I leave today and I think I need to make sure that my house is sealed, is that a big job, or, you know, can that be done kind of quickly? And
it can be done reasonably quickly with the right materials and knowing what you're looking for. We do a lot of proofing work with Rentokil. We seal bases of doors with bristle strips and bumper seals, and we can do like a survey tab that could look at that sort of thing.
Okay.
But it's just looking and being sort of aware that, oh, there's a gap there.
Yeah.
Or like we've had an outside, say you have an outside tap put in, so the cavity wall, you've got some REM access to it, the tap's there, lovely, but it's not sealed, there's a little gap around that I can get a pen in, or I need to seal that. Just small things like that that you don't naturally think about.
Okay, I am learning so much from you, and you are doing a brilliant job of speaking to me very kindly. I really appreciate it, Richard. We will get down to the brass tacks of, you know, what if they're in, what you're going to do. And also, we have some questions coming in for you. If you wouldn't mind just hanging on for a few minutes for us, we'll come back to you. Thank you so much. The font of wisdom when it comes to pests, Richard Faulkner, who is Advanced Technical Field Consultant with Rentokil. If you have a question for him, please send it in to us, 51552, or you can email louise@rte.ie. We will ask him all those questions, but we'll have a little bit of a break first. I need to catch my breath, and we'll hear from Jesse Ware. That's after this.
Where's your favourite place to squeeze in a read? The bus, the bath, the beach, if you're brave enough to battle the Irish weather? Is it feet up in front of the fire, furled up on your favourite futon, or hiding away in your homemade fort? What about squeezing in a read worlds away out west while listening to the waves? On Thursday, 25th of February, Libraries Ireland are hosting Ireland Reads, a national day to celebrate reading. And it doesn't matter where you squeeze in a read or what you read, so long as you do, will you squeeze in a read with us? Find your perfect read and take the pledge at irelandreads.ie, an initiative of the Government of Ireland, a part of the Keep Well campaign. Whew, what a squeeze.
RTE, supporting the arts.
When you set off with the Irish Navy, it can take you anywhere.
With on-the-job training like no other. Job skills, life skills, personal skills. Skills that will not only set you apart for life, but will set you up for life. With the opportunity to follow your own ambitions and specialize in what interests you the most. Set off with us. Go anywhere. Launch your career with the Irish Navy and expand your horizons. Find out how to join our team at navy.ie.
Oh, David, don't tell me you bought me a
grand Big Mac. I'd do anything for you, darling. I knew from them.
Sorry, guys. Would you mind? I've got more drama to do.
The grand Big Mac is back at McDonald's, and there's nothing grander than a grand Big Mac. Served after 11 a.m. until the 23rd of March. Participating restaurants only. Subject to availability. Delivery charges may apply.
Oh, QFM.
The countdown is on. Launching this Tuesday is Star on Disney Plus. Their new general entertainment brand comes with over 75 TV series, more than 270 movies, 4 exclusive Star originals, and it's got more new content being added monthly. To help bring this whole world of TV and movie favorites to your home, we've got 50-inch smart TVs and iPads to be won. Find out more with Dearn and Own, celebrating the launch of Star on Disney Plus this Monday from 6.
Louise McSherry on 2FM.
Thank you.
the beautiful Jessie Ware singing Remember Where You Are. That is a song from her absolutely incredible album that came out last year. If you haven't listened to that, frankly, I don't know what you're doing with your life. It's the gig, one of the gigs I think I'm most looking forward to post this. Now, that was a nice break, but unfortunately we have to get back to the show, which is talking and learning about rodents and how to prevent them from getting into your house and what to do if they are already in your house. I know that this is something that's tricky for some people. It's tricky for me. Although Anya has tweeted and saying that I'm making her feel a lot better about her crippling fear of mice. Like, look, I realize it's ridiculous. Rationally, I know it's silly. Like, they can't do anything to me, but it's, you know, these fears are not rational, and we can all bind together in this. But we have some questions for you, Richard. Richard Faulkner is with us, and he is the Advanced Technical Field Consultant with Rentokil. So, Richard, I'm just going to get stuck into the questions because I think we'll learn as we go there. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's brilliant.
Okay, first question. Do sonar alarms help get rid of rodents?
So by sonar alarms, they're probably talking about ultrasonic devices. Rats and mice do hear in ultrasonic frequencies, but it's what that is actually communicating to them. So there are devices out on the market, but generally, no. When I was at university doing behavioural ecology module, my lecturer at the time, this is back long ago in sort of the early to mid-90s, so I'm giving away my age, he was doing work with it and power stations, and he had pictures of mice sitting on the ultrasonic devices.
Okay.
So, yeah, not really.
Not going to do it for you. Okay.
No.
Just wondering what to do. I actually can't believe I'm about to say this. Just wondering what to do if a rat is in the sewer pipe near the back of your toilet.
Right. So the common rats, especially in urban areas, will exploit our sewer systems, our water, food, a stable environment, and no predators go down them. But rats, especially when water levels get high, will move around pipes. The other one that's a really big one is the soil stack, which vents your sewer system. It goes up into your attic and out. Sometimes they will travel up the sewer stack. If you've not got the little cage on the top where the pipe leaves your roof, and they'll pop up out of that pipe and then sometimes get in under your eaves. So yeah, it is possible, but very, very unlikely.
Mm. And what do you do?
I say call me at the end of the day, really, on that one. There's certain things that, like that, again, it's looking what you're doing. So if you've got your soil stack, should have a little cage on the top of it, because basically what that does, as well as stopping stuff from coming out, it also stops birds nesting and blocking it, which then can cause gas backups and stuff like that in the sewer system. It's just a venting system. If we've got rats in our, and sometimes in urban areas, we come out to look at a problem, we say, look, you need to get a drain survey just to get into your building via the drains, especially if you've, again, had work done and you might have an uncapped drain under the floor or something like that. And you can put in these things called drain interceptors or non-return valves, which are basically, we call them rat flaps, which allow your waste and everything to flow out but stops anything coming back up the drain system.
And tell me, who would you call? Is it a plumber who would do that for you?
Again, this sort of thing. So a drain survey, yeah, they're drain survey companies.
Okay.
Usually, again, anything like that, I'd get it advised at sort of survey point by a pest controller.
Okay.
Because sometimes it might not be that, but again, we can pop certain things and say, well, right, this needs to be looked at in terms of detail.
I could call you, Richard, and get you or one of your guys to come out to my house and look, even if I don't think there's a problem, and just look and see there's a potential problem. Yes, all right.
Like we've got a free phone number, which is 1890 666 444, just for advice and all that sort of stuff as well, and questions like that.
Okay.
And also our website's really good, which is www.rentokil.ie.
Okay.
So we're there from that point of view as well.
Excellent. Okay. My question's disappeared, but basically the question was from someone who has rats in their back garden, and the rats are eating dog poo in the back garden. They see them eating dog poo in the back garden. Well, I mean, I presume you need to be getting rid of the dog poo.
Yeah, that would be the first answer straight away. So remove the food source, which is, it's not a pleasant one for this time in the morning. First time I've ever been asked that question, what should I do if the rats are eating dog poo? To me, that shows the rats are really quite hungry as well. Ideally, clean up the garden, take away the food source, get the dog waste into proper sealed bins, have a good clean up from that point of view.
Okay, I have a few questions about insects now, yes. If you don't mind. We have ants in the kitchen sometimes and I've no idea where they're coming from. What should I look for on how they are getting in?
Right, so again, ants, really, really tiny, really hard to stop. It's more than likely our black garden ant, Lasius niger. And they're usually what we call a seasonal pest. They don't usually start really getting active until early spring and then into late autumn. But again, because our weather's milder, we will get anomaly cases all through the year. Mm. They're foraging, they're looking for food. So it's all really about housekeeping, keeping your cleaning, cleaning as you go, wipe up surfaces, that sort of thing. When you're looking for ant activity, you're looking for the little lines of ants. Because what they do, they go out and forage. When they find a food source, they emit pheromones so that the others can follow it. So that's why they're running back and forth in lines. It's because they're following the pheromone trail to the food source and then taking it back to the nest.
Okay. All right.
So if the nest is on your property, brilliant. It can be treated. If it's not, then the best thing to do, really, again, get some us out, get Rentokil out, and we'll look and put in insect bait stations outside.
Can
which
you,
is targeted for ants.
Yeah, can you, if you see the, like, you know, the ant hills?
Yes.
What should you do with one of those?
So if we see that, so the little ant hills are basically ventilation shafts for their nest complex. So if we see those, we just directly treat the area on that. We treat it with an insecticide.
Okay, so they're underground.
Yes.
And then that, okay, got it. I see, I'm okay with the insects, I'm fine. Okay, let's, this next question says, what can I do to get rid of silverfish permanently? They just always seem to come back.
Yeah, it's mad. Silverfish, the last sort of 4 or 5 years have become really prevalent. We're dealing with a lot more cases than we ever did. And a lot of it's about weather conditions and humidity. Mm. They like high relative humidity and they like moisture. So if we take that out, it's going to affect them. The other thing is they're starch feeders. Mm-hmm. They like starch, like cellulose. So it's, again, really high-level cleaning from that point of view. They're a nuisance pest. They can damage the old painting and stuff like that, as long as there's anything that's got starch in it. But it's more of a nuisance pest. Mm-hmm. So it's really about sealing all your gaps on your skirting, tiling, grouting, so they've got nowhere to hide, thorough cleaning, and also, if you've got birds nesting, sometimes birds nest can lead to silverfish outbreaks.
Oh, okay. So like if there's a bird nesting in your chimney or whatever.
Yeah, or in your eaves, then it could be that that was the original source of it, if possible.
Okay. All right. That's good to know. And this person wants to know, do we have cockroaches in Ireland? They saw them on their J1 in America and have never stopped thinking about them.
Yes, we do.
We do? Oh, great. Do. That's great news, isn't it?
Line, yeah. We actually have four species that will readily sort of colonise and breed. The main two are the German cockroach and the Oriental cockroach.
That's not very politically correct.
Well, that's what they're called. Blattella germanica and Blattella orientalis. Can't help that one. And then there's the Australian cockroach and the American cockroach. Mm. So everybody's getting a bit of it from that point of view.
Yeah. Okay. All right. And I presume it's just the same deal as with the other insects on that one.
Cockroach is a little bit different because they're incomplete metamorphosis. They're omnivores, so they're very similar to the insect version of a mouse, really, because they feed on both animal and plant protein, really good scavengers, and they're just really, really hard to get to because they've got an egg case called an ootheca, which they hold the eggs in. So the German cockroach, she holds her egg case for a month. She's a really good mum. When she drops it, 38 to 40 eggs hatch out into nymphs, which are mini-me versions.
Right.
So that can be the Oriental cockroach. They only carry their ootheca for 4 or 5 hours and drop it. It takes 2 months for that egg case to develop and hatch out into nymphs. Mm-hmm. So you could do a treatment and knock down the adults, but you've got Oriental ootheca's and wall cavities in your drains.
Okay,
and
so
then you get problems later. So it's a proper integrated program with them.
Yes, what I have learned from you this morning, I've learned a lot from you, Richard. Thank but you. What I the main thing that I have learned is that prevention is the key.
Yeah, it's better to be proactive than reactive. It really
so,
is.
So, if I were concerned about this, I would be going home and cleaning my kitchen very thoroughly. I would be getting a pest control person to come out and check and make sure that all my little gaps are filled or whatever. I would be moving the bins far away from my house.
Yeah.
I would be clearing my garden of any vegetation whatsoever.
Yeah, and definitely dog poo as well, by the sounds of it.
Yes, okay.
That would be a good one.
Well,
and then just inside, it's clean as you go.
Yeah.
Attics, because they're nice and quiet. And again, with the common rat, we've got to be really careful because that needs water. So if you've got, and you should have a water tank in your attic, make sure that's properly covered.
Okay.
And that's a really good hint as well.
Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate you and your patience with me. That is Richard Faulkner, Advanced Technical Field Consultant with Rentokil. Richard, I hope you have a lovely day.
And you, take care.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for having me.